you talk about how you find that part time when you are abroad from the
end? Yeah. Well, I do often work with the public and encouraging public people to engage in sort of playful performance and find ways of making that more frequent so that people can find the place to play and engage in art themselves and performance art. And so Nancy knew that about me. I've quite often done things in French festivals and I was thinking, do I want to do something for the festival this year? And then when Nancy asked me if I wanted to meet Kazu and become involved in this work, I thought, well, that's a really interesting thing to come in on something that's already a process that's happening rather than start from the beginning somewhere myself. So I was very curious to meet him. When I did meet him with Nancy, I thought, well, this sounds really interesting and I'd like to become involved. And so at that point, Kazu introduced me to this Amanda. And Amanda, I thought, well, and also even when we first met, I thought, one of the things I often do when I'm trying to engage the public is to do it as a character. Because if you just approach somebody as oneself, it can feel a little bit threatening to people. Why is this person accosting me and why are they talking to me and like go away? But if you are obviously just slightly altered and you're approaching them as a kind of playful character, I found they much more quickly kind of relax and start being a little bit playful themselves in response. So I decided I needed a character and I needed a new one because I have other characters. But when Nancy said, I want you to be your art, you know, Kazu said, I want you to be a choreographer. I thought, oh, I've never thought of myself as a choreographer. You know, because I do movement work, but I don't really work in the theatre or on the stage. But I thought, well, that's a kind of interesting thing for me to play with. So that's when I thought, well, catwalk. And then I thought, a long story. But then I thought, well, I would find the name of cat in another language. So kostyum means cat in Russian. Oh, that's kind of interesting. So, I sort of think cats, move as though they're being watched, and that's kind of interesting. So when I met Amanda, I thought, we had a conversation, and I knew Amanda had some concerns about the interaction with the public not taking over from the work and not bringing it into kind of a theatrical sort of overplaying. She was talking to me, and Kazu was talking to me, and they wanted people to just experience themselves, not for them to become a character. So it was a really interesting conversation to think of how we could activate the work, how to encourage people to enter the work and feel themselves part of it, but to do it in a natural way. So there were a lot of conversations about how to achieve that. And I knew that because we needed people to be here every day, and that I don't live on the island, that I needed to find a team of people to help me in my role. So, and I teach art therapy at White Cliff, so I thought, well, my students can come, and people can really support with me to come. So I got a group of men to come over and try wearing the garments and learn how, because one of the big challenges of these garments is to get people in and out of them. Because for a start, they're black, so they all look the same. So you have to teach people this pair of trousers goes with this one, and this, but also to, the more complex ones to actually help people to be able to put them on over their clothes and to be able to move them without having too many disasters. A little bit of falling off is quite funny, but and how to put them on little kids without them tripping. So it's been quite an interesting journey just in to figure out what the role is of the person helping the public to put them on, to move in them successfully. What I really like about the garments for two people is because people are busy relating to each other and relating to the garment, they lose their self-consciousness about, oh, I'm being looked at. Oh, the other thing we were looking at is activate what Kazu wanted people who were in the audience sitting on the railway seat to view themselves as being part of the group, not just sort of passively sitting watching other people. So we often make little jokes about people who've got cameras. Oh, you're in the press gallery, you're part of the paparazzi, so you go and sit over here. And, oh, are you a buyer from Vogue? Or, we're trying to kind of get people to have the idea that just by sitting there watching, they are part of the group as well. So we do have to try and kind of encourage people to view themselves in that way.
So the black thing has this
interactive, having a dress and having a choreographer to relate to the audience. But white scene is completely different. It should be told by Jackie, but what she hears. Their idea, her idea, is to let the garden tell the audience how to do it. But of course, they have to have some attendance to look after the garden. But other than that part, they are quite very minimal interaction in theory. But a black guy, lots of people attend them. But their own idea is quite different. But that is how Jackie wanted to come. So how do you see this difference between your idea having a choreographer for the garden?
It's interesting because I didn't actually plan to have a choreographer at the start. I thought that I guess it was just something I didn't really think about. That it would just work itself out, that people would work out how to get into the garden and that sort of thing. But I'm really, really pleased that we didn't go ahead with that because nothing would happen. I mean, seriously, you see these guys up here? I love the way they look when they're hanging on their hands, but they just, you don't know what they are. They're just sort of blobs of strange little things coming out of them. And I love that. But you can't figure out what to do with them yourself if you don't have someone just being that interface and literally helping you. There's
sorts
of strange gaps that you go into that don't look like the bottom.
It's quite interesting to see what people
make. Yeah, but you would never get someone having two people in the air at once. That's the thing. We did think that. When I actually talked about it, even last week we talked about having just one session where people could just do whatever they wanted. But I actually tried that on Thursday. I was looking after the work and I did try it and it just didn't work. People just don't. I think you know a lot about this. People need to know that they're not doing the wrong thing with this.
Yeah. But it's a whole culture of touching out.
Yeah. So basically, it's just overcoming those barriers a little bit and just letting them experience. And the fact that two people are in the room together is, I mean, the way that this works has been really surprising to me. I mean, I knew that it would be a little bit confronting, but when you actually see people out there, it actually. People get quite emotional about it. It sort of breaks down barriers for them, and sometimes you see couples doing it together, and sort of they walk up and they're very separate, and then they go into the woods, and then they're laughing together, and you know they're really intimate, touching each other, but in public, and you can sort of see that their experiences are challenging together as well, and then they come out of the garden something, and it's just changed the way that they their body language together, and all that sort of thing. It was actually really surprising to me how that would work. And also not just people, but people, fathers and sons,
teenagers together. They go on the back to back, and initially they think they're going to just, but they actually have to cooperate. And you do see this kind of shift happen, where they can't just do their own thing, and they can't, it won't work if they don't cooperate. And there's been some really moving things. And they've got into it, and then another two teenagers see it happening, and they want to have a try, and then they've got a whole plan of how they're going to do it together. Oh, yeah, Sally's over, I'm going to do that. And so they started to choreograph their own ideas. It's really exciting to see the imagination start to spark about what can I do with it. So it's no longer, it starts to be a creative act for those people to be in the garden.
And for me, to answer your question, that the reason why we have the activators, the choreographers, is to enable that to happen, because otherwise people need to be instructed about what they need to do together, and they need just some practical advice. sometimes the activating has been an exercise of sticking back a little bit, I think.
Yeah.
So you do need to give people room to experiment. And we actually talked originally with Lisa and Sharon about that there were these concepts behind the outlets, the dancers, the lovers, and the fighters. But we thought that there's no need to actually state that to people participating in the work, because the garments actually, once you're in them, you can feel, you're literally physically experiencing. accessing those states. And so it doesn't need to be explained, it's actually discovered in the process of hearing that.
Yeah, we're quite careful not to name the patterns. We just sort of say a little bit about, you know, because you can, some of them are more appropriate for some people than others, you know, like, so you can kind of see, oh, well, I'm not going to put those in the lover's garment because they're not a couple, or they won't be comfortable close that close together or something. So it's that thing of someone saying, oh, I've got just the thing for you, and you know, you just start dressing them up, and they're kind of, oh, okay, I've got joined leg, and I've got this, and I've got to figure that out. But so yeah, we've tried to let them have their own experience, what it is about, and then when they put that particular garment on,
we've tried to make the rough ones, you know, just the test ones to sort of make them up, and that we had some people try them on, and see what they were, and we didn't tell them what they were, and watch them put them on and get them, you know, and there would be that moment of surprise when they finally make it work and they go, oh, we're dancing!
Yeah.
And then suddenly they recognize what it was they were trying to do. So
and a lot of that was around doing some research by just, you know, how do people do a tango hold each other? Where do the hands go? One hand on the shoulder, one's on the waist. And so the little hand holds are there. So naturally, you fall into that position.
Yeah.
And with the fighters, just that little touch of the vinyl on the back of the hand, which alludes to a boxing glove. It's not a big punchy thing. We didn't want to overstate it. But it's just there. It's just,
yeah.
Probably, it makes the end.
Yeah, I just say, oh, punch your fingers up and put your thumb through the hole. And as soon as they do that, they kind of pull it through.
You
can't
get your hands
like that.
Yeah.
And but even when they discover the little cut, you say, now you put your arm up there and put your hand out through that hole, and they go, oh, that's clear. You know, they kind of get quite delighted that there's a little, there's somewhere for all their hands to go. And they, and there's something really beautiful about the hands showing on the outside of the mat. You know, there's something very poignant about, you know, little baby's hand sort of on the back of their father's shoulders or something poking out through the little holes. Or, yeah, they're really